business is God wants to do business with us.
Okay.
Good.
Okay, go ahead and turn to John 4, because we're going to talk a little bit about, Chuck says we're going to talk about abundance today. Well, we are kind of. Unless he's preaching, that's not exactly what we're going to talk about. But today we're going to talk about how confrontation brings revelation. And you know, sometimes I am the person who does not like confrontation, honestly. I have a really good friend of mine. He loves it. He loves to put these provoking things on his Facebook. And when I see it, I'm like, ooh, I would not do that. I am just not that person. You know, if I'm going to have confrontation, I want it to be face-to-face. I want to have discussion about it. I want to pray about it, that kind of thing. I am just, that is not my gift. I do not have a gift for confrontation. But I do it if I have to. But what I realized this week is confrontation, when it comes around you, toward you, at you, makes you have revelation if you go about it the right way. If you don't go about it the right way, it just makes you mad. I mean, seriously. You know, it just aggravates you. But when you feel that confrontation coming towards you, then you press into God, what are you saying to me? And I'll tell you something, this is funny. I got an email from somebody, I think it was Tuesday or Wednesday, and I knew them, I haven't seen them, I just barely knew them to begin with. And they sent me an email explaining to me how I've gotten off track. They had read a blog, one out of the 40 I've written, and they explained to me how my blog was self-centered, selfish, leading people down the wrong path, fueling the me generation. I'm thinking, well, you know, when people say things, even though it irritates you, it irritates me, I always say, okay, God, is there any truth in that? You know, because sometimes truth comes in a way that is not exactly sugar, it's vinegar. You know, it has a little bit of a bite to it. So, you know, I'm thinking about it. First of all, I'm trying to figure out who they are. And I'm sitting there going, okay, who are they? And they did go to, I actually don't know who they are, but I know that I know them, I just can't remember them. Does that make sense? Yeah, so I sent them back a note and I said, you know, I appreciate your input and, you know, kind of addressed what they mentioned, and they sent back even more. And that's when I said, okay, Lord, is this from you or is this a distraction for me? And so I read what they write, and it was actually quite interesting, because what I realized is they didn't know me. You know how you run into somebody and they do something that, you know, may bother you or something, and immediately you just have like an assessment of who they are. Well, they read something that I wrote, and immediately they had this assessment of who I was. They had decided that, you know, I was, they even used the flavor of Joel Osteen. And I was like, well, I don't know. But they had made an assessment of who I was based on one thing they wrote. Amen. I thought that was an amen. That's exactly how I felt about it. Let's know.
That was the lyrics right there.
But, you know, in thinking about this, when I was at the pastor's meeting a couple of weeks ago, you know, one of the things that Patricia King talked about was when people confront or come against her, the one thing she does is she says, I go low. First of all, I get on my knees and ask God, what are we talking about here? And she says, and second of all, I began to come next to them and serve them and encourage them and try to understand the perspective that they have. And, you know, when we do that, what it does is it knocks down the walls of resistance between us and someone else. And I think this is a great lesson, you know, as bodies of believers who all belong to the same family. I think it's a great lesson for us. So I'm going to talk a little bit about what happens you know, how do we confront inside the body? Because confrontation gives us revelation. We know that that's how we all got saved. Because we were confronted by the sin we were carrying with the love of Jesus. And we had the revelation that if we say yes to him, then we can move from an old life filled with sin and uncertainty to a new life filled with wonder and love and acceptance. So we understand that that confrontation makes us think if we press into thinking, or it makes us mad, you know. And sometimes it makes us mad, then it makes us think. You know, we're not perfect people. We can't say, oh, that didn't really bother me. Because it does. Because, you know, when you're being challenged as a person or your character or whatever you're saying, you're thinking, what do they mean? And then you're like, okay, God, what do they mean? So I want to, I know I told you to turn to John 4, but we're going to switch that for a minute. I'll go back to John 4. Let's look at Acts 15, 5 through 12. Sometimes God just wants us to be confronted, and sometimes we don't like it. But he wants us to be confronted so we can be better. We can be better in him. We can know him. We can be transformed, because this confrontation brought us a revelation of who Jesus is to replace what needs to be gone. So here we're in Acts, and we're, you know, they're having this great debate over circumcision. Yes, Joel, that's what they're debating. Acts 5. It says, but some from the sect of the Pharisees who had believed in Jesus as the Messiah, so these are believers, right, stood up and said, it is necessary to circumcise the Gentile converts and to direct them to observe the law of Moses. So there is the issue that's going to be a stickler. The apostles and the elders came together to consider this matter. And after a long debate, Peter got up and said to them, brothers, you know that in the early days God made a choice among you. And by my mouth, the Gentiles would hear the message of the gospel and believe. And God, who knows and understands the heart, testified to them, giving them the Holy Spirit just as he also did to us. And he made no distinction between us and them, cleansing their hearts by faith in Jesus. Now then, why are you testing God by placing a yoke on the neck of the disciples, which neither our fathers nor we have been able to endure? Verse 11, but we believe that we are saved through the precious, undeserved grace of Lord Jesus, which makes us free from guilt of sins and grants us eternal life. In just the same way as they are. And all the people remained silent, and they listened attentively to Barnabas and to Paul as they described all the signs and wonders, attesting miracles that God had done through them and among the Gentiles. You know, I found that kind of interesting, because they're going through this long debate, and then they begin to testify to all that God has done. You would think that they would just keep pressing into whatever the discussion is. But you know, Peter's making this, okay, this is what the Lord has shown me, that the Gentiles will come just like us. They'll be clean just like us. They'll be filled just like us. And by the way, let me tell you all that God's doing. Let me tell you all the miracles that God's doing. Let me tell you all the things, the signs and the wonders that are happening. So here he goes through this, and then they begin the deeper discussion, and we're not going to read all that, but I do want to talk about when we are believers and we are challenged with other believers, whether it's their theology, whether it's what they've been trained. I was with someone a couple of weeks ago, and they were explaining to me why David couldn't build the temple. And their explanation was what they had learned, but it was not biblical.
That's right.
And sometimes we've been taught certain things about what God thinks or what he believes, but we haven't had that confrontation to bring revelation to what it really says. And we all have those little nuances that have been poured into us from our culture, from our you know, denominations, from our families. Like, I grew up Baptist, and I was told that it was a sin if you wore a dress above your knees. You know, and I was like 6 years old. So, you know, I think my dress hit right at the crease, and my grandmother made me walk pulling it down because it was too short. And I was like, I didn't know how that computed. I couldn't quite get that right. And of course, I could have lived that life, the rest of my days, and not worn pants to church and only wore dresses below my knees, but I had a revelation. And it probably wasn't a holy revelation. It probably was a rebellious revelation that finally came, okay, dress modestly was the whole point. But you know, we learn things as we're children, as we're adults, as we're just coming into Christ, as we read things in the paper or in the, you know, the Time magazine does the whole thing about Jesus. We learn things that we think are true, but they're not actually true. And the sect of Pharisees, they believed because that was what they knew, and that was what the law was. At the time, every male had to be circumcised. And so this debate was, do they have to be circumcised to be saved? Because that's what they knew. And so the church had to come together and figure that out. You know, Peter's saying, as far as I know, that's not what the requirement is. You know, being with Jesus, having that encounter on the rooftop where the unclean things came down, and Jesus tells them, you know, they're not unclean, to bring in the Gentiles. This is his understanding. So they bring everybody together and they have this discussion. And after they have this discussion, it doesn't say that half of them got left and decided to start their own church. What it says is, James sends out this letter and says, it seems good to the Holy Spirit, and it seems good to us, so this is what we're going to do. And I believe that God is really challenging us in our confrontation of one another. And he's challenging us to come together and let's pray through. Okay, this is what I believe God has shown us through the word. Okay, you believe that there is something different. Well, let's get together and pray through it. And let's not move forward fighting with each other until we have a breath of the Holy Spirit on this. So let's not continue the contention. Let's let the Holy Spirit breathe on us. And let him come up with what is right by God. And we know that each of us could read a same section of scripture and have a different interpretation to what it is. And it doesn't mean that my interpretation is going to be better than yours. It could be one may have a prophetic interpretation of it. It could be, you know, one may have a literal interpretation of it. But what we are trying to do is do what's right by the Holy Spirit and what we find in unity with one another. Because we talk about, we put it all on the table. We say, hey, this is what I'm thinking. This is where I think it is. And in the email, finally, I sent him a thing and said, appreciate your input. Definitely have talked about it with my people. I have a people of accountability around me. And I don't think it'd be appropriate for me to have coffee with you. So thank you. And the response was, it's not my fault that I believe that about you. That actually was the response. It's your fault because in your blog that you wrote, you did not give enough information about where you stood and what you've done. And I'm like, thank you. Because what you see is somebody didn't want to know. I said, you're welcome to come to our church, Chuck, and I would love to have you. Someone didn't want to know who I was and what I've done. They wanted to take their filter of where they've been and what their hurts were, or whatever it is, whatever their perspective, whatever their need was, and decide that I needed to be transformed. And probably say this again, you know, in order to satisfy what they needed. And in this body of believers, we have people that we don't agree with. Don't we? Yes. And we have people that we think they're wrong. And we have people that they think we're wrong. But what we have to find is that space where the Holy Spirit can breathe on one another. That space where we can say, we've prayed and we've rested and we've waited and we have found. Now it is right by the Holy Spirit and it's right by us. We've come in unity with what the Holy Spirit is saying. And we can move forward without brokenness because we've rested and we've waited. We have not battled and talked about one another. This is a great Pentecost message, isn't it? I thought y'all would like this. I actually had earlier in the week planned on doing something else. And I was like, you are so much fun. Let's do what I want to do. I'm like, okay. So I'm just going to read a scripture out of Colossians. And I just want us to think about this. Colossians 4, 5, and 6. And it's talking about how do we engage with one another as believers. We're not talking about someone who does not believe. We're talking about how do I treat you because you're in the family of Jesus with me. How do I treat you? It says, conduct yourself with wisdom in your interactions with outsiders, non-believers. Oh, I'm sorry, I read the wrong one. Sorry, that was for the next one. We'll talk about that in a minute. I'm sorry, Ephesians 5, 15 through 21. Sorry. Okay, 15. Now this is about talking about when we're dealing with each other. Therefore, see that you walk carefully, living life with honor, purpose, and courage. Courage. Shunning those who tolerate and enable evil, not as the unwise, but as wise, sensible, intelligent, discerning people. That's who we are. We're to walk carefully. Verse 16 says, making the most of your time on earth, recognizing and taking advantage of each opportunity and using it with wisdom and diligence, because these days are filled with evil. Verse 19, speak to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, offering praise by singing and making melody with your heart to the Lord, always giving thanks to God, the Father, for all things, in the name of our Lord Jesus, and being subject to one another out of reverence for Christ. Do you think you can walk in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs and singing and melody in our heart when we're in conflict with someone?
No.
It's hard. But do you think by the power of the Spirit that we can do that? Because even when you think about the songs that David sung, not all of them were, I love you so much. The guy who's trying to kill me, I just love you so much. You know, when we're really authentic with one another and we're able to say, you know, let's just dial this down a minute and let's see what the Holy Spirit wants to say and breathe on this. And if at this point we can't do this, then let's just take a step back and agree. Separation and prayer will help bring us back together. Let us just let the Holy Spirit breathe on us. So when we get done, and there may be little nuances that down the road, you know, that we'll never agree on. You know, we know that there's little things that we're never going to agree on. But are those enough things to cause us to lash out against the other? Is it enough to cause us to begin a campaign against another ministry, against another person? To begin a little firestorm of, you know, judgment against that one or that group that ruffles our feather? Or do we have enough presence of God in us to go low and to say, you know, I am part of the body, and we may not share everything identical. You may not have every identical belief I have, but what I know is that Jesus has called me to love you, and that I'm going to have a revelation of things tomorrow and the next day and 10 years down the road that I don't have right now. And I trust that you will too. So in all of this, my cry to you is, let's be family. Let's be in relationship. And if we can't be in a healthy relationship, then let's just be at peace and know that the Holy Spirit will work these things out. That God will continue to work on our hearts until our hearts are flipped over, right? Because until our hearts flip, it doesn't matter what somebody else is doing. God's after our heart. You know, when Peter, you know, is following Jesus, and Jesus said, feed my sheep, feed my lambs, all that. And he says something about a disciple. He goes, well, what about him? Jesus is like, what is that to you? It's not about John. It's about your heart. It's about our individual hearts. And if we maintain and take care of our hearts, then we don't have to worry about somebody else's heart, because we're going to trust God to work on them. Now, we want to help them, right? That's our job, is to help and boss and do all that kind of stuff. But what we've got to do is we've got to do it in the middle of the Holy Spirit. And there are times where conflict and confrontation can get salty. We know that. But we have to be able to breathe in and say, Holy Spirit, I just need you to show me how to breathe on this. I need for you to show me how to serve, how to go low, how to be able to break down the wall that's been put up between us and them. So that's how we have conflict inside the body. We go low and let the Holy Spirit breathe on it. And then we separate ourselves if we're not able to maintain what God says, being wise and thoughtful and encouraging to one another. Now, I do want to do the outside of the body too, the non-believers. John 4, we'll go there now, 4:7. And I'm just going to talk about this a little bit, and then I'll read the very end of it, John 4:7. And this is a very familiar story. I'm sure I've preached on it many times. Fotini is the Samaritan woman. That's who they've discovered who she is through some stuff outside of the Bible. So you can believe that or not believe it. It's all good. But anyhow, you know, Jesus is going. He decides to go to Samaria. He goes to the well, and he asks her for a drink. And she's, you know, can you imagine someone who is ostracized and not even allowed to be in the same space? Can you imagine what that was like for her? You know, who is this Jew coming, asking me for water? You know, is he coming to kill me? Is he coming? I mean, you know, I can imagine what went through her mind. But verse 7, it says, the woman from Samaria came to draw water, and Jesus said to her, give me a drink. Verse 8, for his disciples had gone to the city to buy food. The Samaritan woman asked him, how is it that you, being a Jew, ask me, a Samaritan woman, for a drink? Jesus answered her, if you knew about the gift, God's gift, and who it is who says, give me a drink, you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water. Here is, we're going to call Jesus a believer, because that's the illustration I'm using, but think about it. Here's Jesus coming to the Samaritan woman who does not know. And the first thing he says is, if you knew about God's gift. The other stuff he gets into, you know, go call your husband. Oh, I have five of them. You know, the one you're not living with. You know, all that revelation comes. But the first thing he does is he says, if you knew about God's gift. And what does that do to someone's heart? Here's someone that he's not even supposed to get near. And she knows that. And he just says to her, if you knew about God's gift. And she knows who God is. And that was the extension that hooked her heart. I mean, it just took her apart. She, of course, they go back and forth because she's trying to understand. She knows the law. She understands where the conflict is. And she's just like, I'm trying to get my head around this. Verse 12, she says to him, are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us the well and who used to drink from it himself and his sons and also his cattle? And he just says to her, whoever drinks this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks the water that I give will never be thirsty again, but the water that I give him will become in him a spring of water, satisfying his thirst from God, welling up, continually flowing, bubbles within him to eternal life. And the woman says, give me the water. I mean, if someone's saying everything that your spirit is crying out for, I am offering to you, what are you going to say? I don't know, thanks. You're going to say, give me the water. And she had that confrontation that brought her revelation. And with his heart extended toward her, he was able to help her unpack the sin he was about to forgive so she could enter into eternal life. That is our job as people who encounter people who are not believers. Our job is to see, okay, God, where is their love language? Where's their love loss that I can reach in and say, you know, if you just knew the gift that God has. And it's not always that phrase. You know, sometimes it's like, I just see that you are the most amazing nurturer or provider or whatever it is. All of a sudden, you've hooked them with the heart of God for them. I was meeting with some people a few weeks ago, and they were trying to figure out how to handle a situation in their home where a relative was in a life of sin. But they weren't a believer. The relative didn't know God. They just didn't know. They hadn't encountered the love of God. So sitting down and reading to them about their sin is not going to hook their heart. Sitting down and telling them about the love that you want to pour out on them, that's the hook of the heart. And it's easy, you know, when we point out someone's sin, whether it's in the scripture or whether it's just like, you know, you need to be doing this, what it does is it keeps us from having to be emotionally invested in them. Because when we're detached by teaching and instructing them, instead of authentic by pouring into them, then it just becomes an exchange of information. It's not a heartbreaking revelation for them to grab a hold of. And I don't want you to misunderstand that there's never a time that you pull out your Bible and you go through it with them. Because I always say, what does the Word say? You know, or I believe in the Word. Do you want to hear what I think God's saying about this? But what I'm saying is that we have so many opportunities to draw in someone's heart into the heart of God. And we just have to see, how does God want us to do it? How does God want us to say, hey, I see what's in you? Or I have something that you cannot resist. I have something that will make you be filled again with joy and hope. I have the answer to the problem that you have. Have you seen the new Scientology billboards? They have their own TV channel now. I think it's on Direct or Dish. I can't remember which I saw it. And they're saying, I know what you've heard about me, but do you want to know the truth? Because they're trying to get, and they have commercials that say, you know, are you depressed? Are you sad? Do you need help finding hope in your life? You know, they're trying to get the people who have a preconceived notion about them watch our TV channel, we'll tell you all about us. And they're trying to get people who have no hope and have nowhere to go. So if you've lost hope, you're financially whatever, then just call this number. I mean, that is a relational strategy. They're trying to reach out to people who need answers. And that's what God has called us to do. But we have the only answer, the only answer available, and that is Jesus. And I'm going to read that Colossians scripture, because I want us to, on this day of Pentecost, I want us to realize that confrontation brings revelation. But you've got to have the right avenue of confrontation. I mean, how many of you watch Fox or CNN and think, boy, this is the best confrontation I've ever heard. This is the life I want to lead, is yelling at each other and, you know, cutting each other off. That, we don't want life like that. It doesn't mean it doesn't happen, but that's not our heart. Our heart is to provide the hook of Jesus for them to grab hold of. That's our heart. We want everyone to come to the saving knowledge of Christ, not only for eternal life, but for a life on earth that has been planned by God for them. And it's not just for them, but it's for everybody around them. The kingdom advances every time someone says yes, because there's greater workers for the kingdom. Okay, we're going to read this. Colossians 4:5-6. It says, conduct yourself with wisdom in your actions with outsiders, non-believers. Make the most of each opportunity, treating it as something precious. Let your speech at all times be gracious and pleasant, seasoned with salt, so that you will know how to answer each one who questions you. That's the way we do it. Do I see sunshine shining out there? Okay. God has promised, so we're going to do it. So that's how we interact with people who don't believe. We conduct ourselves with wisdom, making the most of every opportunity, treating it as its precious. Our speech is gracious and pleasant, seasoned with salt, so that we know how to answer each one who questions us. That's how we do it. Heck, we might have to try that out with our family sometime. Yeah, sometimes the closest ones to us are the ones that we have the hardest time with. So I want to close this by saying, I know that God has given us a shift of mindset. That every person we see is either with him or not with him. The ones that are with him, we love, we encourage, we build up, we pray for, we have conflict in the presence of the Holy Spirit. And the ones that aren't with him, we love and we build up and we encourage and we pray for, and we treat every encounter as if it was precious. As if it's the only encounter we're going to have today for the kingdom, for that one person to see that Jesus is good. And he loves them, and he has the greatest gift ever for them. And the yes is on it, and he's just inviting their yes into it. So that yesterday's life is transformed by today's new beginning. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So if you guys will stand, we're going to pray. Then we're going to go rest in the sunshine, baptize. And, you know, it's funny, my daughter got married in October, and she got married outside. It was a big wedding out by a lake, and it wouldn't have been able to be moved inside. And everybody kept saying, what are you going to do? What's your plan B? I said, there is no plan B. This is what we prayed. This is where we're going. And God's just going to work it out for us. And it was the most beautiful day ever. So that's what I trust today. So thank you, guys. So, Lord, we just thank you that we want holy confrontation. Your word says that you, Holy Spirit, have been given to us. And you have been given to us to fill us with wisdom, understanding, to give us power, and to tell us, what is the Father doing so we can do it? So, Lord, we just thank you that
your Spirit has been poured out on all of us. We are not only poured on by your Spirit, but we're filled up by your Spirit. And I want you to bring us holy confrontation that will bring us revelation. Test us on this, God. Let us press in to your word. Let this be like a starting of an engine where we become the most godly, confrontational people that will bring others into the wonder of who you are. Let our hearts be changed so that we can be influencers to theirs. So Lord, I don't know if that's a good thing to ask for, but I feel like we all need to be tested and get better at this holy confrontation. So we just love you, Lord. We trust you. We pray for our time after the service, just for Vasilia and Steve and Irene as they host us and just take care and nurture us. And God, we just thank you for these people being baptized and the ones who have joined in. We just love you, Lord, and we just thank you for Quinn and her heart for you too this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.